Several years ago, when my son Dallin was 4 or 5, I was playing catch with him in the backyard. He was really struggling to catch the ball. We hadn't practiced catching much, so part of that was just practice. But I started to wonder if part of the problem was how I was tossing the ball. There are lots of things I could change to my throw. I could change the distance I was away from my son, the height I released the ball, and the angle I tossed the ball. But what values for each of these would make it easiest for my son to catch the ball? Having the ball go as slow as possible when it hits his hands was one reasonable way to make the ball easiest to catch. So I started to experiment a little with my position and how I was tossing the ball to try to have the ball hit his hands with the least velocity. Well, he and I both got a little frustrated. Then I realized, like the math nerd that I am, I could do some math and figure out how to toss the ball to my son to make it easiest for him to catch. This was especially true about the angle. I knew that tossing the ball at a low angle was not helpful, because I had to get it going really fast so that it wouldn't drop below his hands by the time it got to him. And tossing it high wouldn't be good, because that also required a forceful throw and allowed the ball plenty of time to accelerate by the time it met his hands. So I did what any loving father would do. I went inside, grabbed a paper and a pencil, and did the math. Well, if you know physics well, you should already know the answer to my dilemma. However, I've never had a physics class in my life, and it probably shows in some of our videos, so I had to sit down and do the math. I knew how to model the path of the ball with a pair of parametric equations. Parametric equations are really cool. They are the etch-a-sketch of mathematics. They allow you to break the x and y coordinates apart and move them independently of each other. This allows mathematicians to analyze situations where y is not a function of x, or y is not dependent on the value of x. For example, the path of a looping airplane, or controlling the bit of a CNC mill. Parametric equations also give students ways to draw pictures of some pretty cool things when they're bored in the back of math class. The height of the ball tossed at a given angle, which we'll call theta, velocity, which we'll call v, and height, which we'll call h, is modeled as this equation, where t is time in seconds. The horizontal distance is modeled as this equation. Many of you will be familiar with these equations, but I'll quickly explain a few things. This 4.9 here comes from the acceleration from gravity, half of the 9.8 meters per second squared. The sine and cosine break up the velocity of the throw into horizontal and vertical components, and this constant here accounts for the height of the throw. I was standing about 3 meters away from my son as I tossed the ball, about as close as I dare get before tossing the ball becomes more like handing off the ball. I also noticed that I was leaning over and releasing the ball about the same height of my son's hands, so let's assume the initial height of the ball and my son's hands are the same level. Now, how are we going to find the velocity of the ball when it hits my son's hand? Well, I know enough about physics that ignoring air resistance, the velocity of a thrown object is the same at each height going up as well as going down. This is because the deceleration due to gravity to slow the ball down as it goes up re-accelerates the ball to the same speed as it comes down. This means that as long as I throw my ball at the height of my son's hand, then minimizing the initial velocity is the same as minimizing the final velocity when it hits my son's hands. So we can restate the question we're really trying to answer: at what angle requires a toss of minimal velocity? We already have our initial velocity in our equations, but we also have time, height, and angle. Our question only mentions the quantities of angle and velocity, so maybe there's something we can do to eliminate height and time. If we think about the throw, once I pick an angle, there's only one velocity that I can throw the ball at and have it hit my son's hands. Assuming my son's hands are the size of a point, no wonder he's having such a hard time catching the ball, right? Once I pick an angle, the amount of time it takes for the ball to hit my son's hands is also determined, so we should only need velocity or time in an equation. One reason why the velocity and time is fixed is because graphically, there's only one parabola that could pass through my hands and my son's hands and be leaving my hand at a given angle. Here is one way we can eliminate time. We can treat these equations as a system of equations. We can use the equation that gives the horizontal position to solve for the time that the ball will hit my son's hands, and then substitute that expression in for t in the vertical position equation. Solving for t gives us t equals 3 divided by this expression. Now substituting in for t in the other equation gives us this expression. But we can go even further. Since initial height h is the same as the ending height, then y equals h when the ball hits my son's hands. Subtracting h from both sides gives us an equation that only has the initial velocity and the initial angle, which is what we wanted. Let's solve for the velocity. After a bit of algebra, we get this. I know many of you are probably thinking that I really do love my son to go through all of this math. And yes, I do. This equation that we've ended up with tells us the velocity I need to toss the ball for a given angle in order to have it hit my son's hands. We want v to be the smallest possible. So what angle minimizes the velocity? We can use calculus tools to find the minimum. It looks crazy, but it is solvable by hand if we take the derivative and set it equal to zero. Or if you prefer, you could have Wolfram Alpha do the solving for you. We can also graph the function, since we have velocity as a function of theta, and look for the minimum. Whatever way we choose, we find the optimal angle to be 45 degrees. So for those of you that know physics and have been hanging around to watch me do a bunch of math to find something you knew in an instant, now is the time to laugh. Now if you don't know physics, you may be wondering how a physicist could know so early that the answer to my dilemma would be 45 degrees. Some of you may have guessed 45 degrees without having a good reason, but a physicist knows that the angle that maximizes distance for a given velocity is 45 degrees. And so 45 degrees will also require the least velocity for a given distance. How do physicists know that the angle of 45 degrees maximizes distance for a thrown object, at least ignoring air resistance? They do some math very similar to what we already did. They start with the same equations, but to make this easy on us, let's assume that the initial height, h, is zero. So essentially, we're kicking a ball and wanting to know what angle to kick it for it to go the farthest. So y equals this expression, x equals this expression. Now we need to know when the ball hits the ground. In our earlier problem, we needed to know when the ball hit my son's hands, and we used the horizontal position to solve for t. But that's because we already knew the horizontal distance it had to travel. We don't know that now. We do know that the height will be zero when the ball comes back to the ground, so we can use the y equation, or the vertical position equation, to solve for the time. We set y equals zero, and luckily, we can solve this with factoring. Since we have two factors, the ball is the height of the ground twice, once for each time that makes one of the factors zero. One factor, t, is zero at the beginning of the kick. So the other factor is the one that will tell us the time when the ball hits the ground. Solving for t and plugging in for t in the x equation, or the horizontal position equation, tells us what the horizontal position will be when the ball hits the ground. We want the x-coordinate, or the horizontal position, to be the largest possible, so we want the angle that maximizes this value. We can find that by taking the derivative with respect to theta, setting equal to zero, and then solving. This may look crazy, but to take the derivative, a product rule is really all we need. We can eliminate the constant and end up with sine squared of theta equals cosine squared of theta. Well, that's true when sine equals cosine, which is at 45 degrees, or when sine equals a negative cosine, so at a negative 35 degrees, which is the same as kicking the ball backwards at 45 degrees. One gives the maximum distance, the other the minimum distance. Wow. Well, now you know why a throw of 45 degrees maximizes distance, and a throw of 45 degrees also minimizes the velocity for a throw of a certain distance. So how did my son Dallin do with catching now that I could apply my hard-earned knowledge? Well, I would like to report that he became a great wide receiver or outfielder, but neither of those things happened. However, he does play a mean marimba. Thank you for watching. Please subscribe and share our videos. Be sure to follow Math the World on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook. Thank you so much for your support.